The domain-driven design has its followers and opponents, just like any opinionated approach to programming. I will not take sides in this video because I don't think it is necessary to take sides. Here is the secret. Some elements of DDD are so pervasive that we are now using them in any object-oriented project, DDD or not. The division into entities, value objects and services, object identity, bounded contexts, aggregates, CQRS, which is older than DDD, are the elements we find in any project. Many programmers don't know how many of these ideas came from the DDD, yet they adopt them naturally in their everyday code. That shows there is truth in DDD and another secret that may keep escaping you. The domain-driven design is augmenting object-oriented design. Everything you learned about object-oriented design remains there, but some of that knowledge now gains a higher meaning in DDD. I will first show you the problems we used to sustain if we only applied the traditional object-oriented design in a large project. I will then show you the building blocks of DDD and how they address those problems. Hear me out, DDD addresses the problems. It doesn't solve them. It is not a magic wand. The principal problem we face is complexity, and complexity will remain with or without DDD. It won't just go away. But we can make coping with complexity a whole lot easier if we approach it differently. So let's begin. The complexity in the business domain causes the proliferation of classes. These classes exhibit many interactions. Like a brain, its surface thinks, but its interior contains interconnections and is much more voluminous than the thin surface above. The interactions between classes eventually make a project grind to a halt, as they vastly outnumber the count of classes in the model. That is one pair of pants. Another comes from the application user's view on the matter. We recognize two principal interactions with the system: querying for the data and changing them. Queries of one sort are so dramatic that they earned their own name, reports. We often move reporting aside and deal with reports separately because they can impact the overall system performance. Yet another top-level view of the system comes from its management. An enterprise is not a unified block of people working like bees in a hive, so its software cannot be a single block. Different departments speak slightly different languages, even though they mention the same principal things. Let me give you an example. Suppose we are modeling a large bookstore with many books connected to many cooperating companies, vendors, buyers, and physical stores, and coordinating with numerous online retailers, dealing with pricing and accounting through the entire process. That is a hell of a software to develop. You must be aware of that without saying. Over the years, we have learned to recognize two circles of that software development inferno. One we refer to as intrinsic complexity. That is the complexity of the world. We cannot help it. It is inherent to the problem we are solving, so it will remain constant no matter what we do. The other is accidental complexity. The complexity we developers add on top of the intrinsic complexity of the world. And so we invent programming models and design models. We study computer science to learn how to keep accidental complexity at bay. And we always fail to a degree. That is what makes software development beautiful. You know, if the software were so easy to develop, it would feel like living in the land of eternal spring. Soon enough, everybody would be taking pills and coping with depression. This imperfect software industry we made is a lot more interesting. It keeps you on the edge. This is where the domain-driven design comes in as one possible attempt at reducing accidental complexity in developing complex software systems. Listen to me very carefully. It is one possible attempt at reducing complexity. Not the only one, not even the best one we have, and it will not make the complexity go away. but it will help, and here is how it does its magic. DDD acknowledges that the bookstore software will have different views on the underlying problem. DDD calls those bounded contexts. The idealized book's definition keeps track of the title, one or more authors, the publisher, and even the issue and the edition. None of these seem to touch the physical world. However, the inventory would want to touch and feel those books. It will borrow the term book from the abstract model, stripping it down in the process but adding such things as the number of pieces we possess, their locations on shelves, their mass and volume, etc. The procurement and sales department will borrow a lot from these two, once again stripping off all the attributes they don't care to know. They will add vendors, buyers, cooperating companies, and more. DDD defines the ubiquitous language as the central pillar of the design. Each bounded context speaks a well-defined language shared between the business and the code we write. Since different departments use the same term but mean slightly different things, we adopt the view that every bounded context has its ubiquitous language. Bounded contexts import items from each other via mappings, and so we recognize upstream and downstream bounded contexts. For every concept, there exists a bounded context that owns it as its principal source of truth. Every other bounded context is merely caching a portion of that data. Then we step into a bounded context and look for ways to model it in isolation from everything else. That is how DDD helps break a colossal problem domain into manageable portions. We step into one bounded context at a time, forgetting about all other contexts and only modeling that part of the larger domain. Problem decomposition is a native part of DDD. This is almost a physical level of design, as that is where we encounter particular words from the ubiquitous language, giving them meaning in code. We separate them into entities, value objects, and services. Entities are actively modeling a thing with its state and behavior. They have an ID to track changes in every entity over time. Value objects are just values with no ID or lifetime. Services are all the rest, all behaviors that do not belong to any entity. Services can be standalone classes and proper dependencies, such as those we know from the inversion of control principle and dependency injection. Entities are proper classes, such as we always envisioned in object-oriented design. The domain-driven design adds nothing we didn't have before, yet it puts a layer of meaning over the naked concepts of object-oriented design. That is where things become interesting. Look, to model books, we may have the book entity and the person entity. A person who authors a book becomes the book author. Why book? Why not publication, issue, bundle, whatever? Because of the ubiquitous language. If the domain expert calls it a book, then we programmers call it a book. There could be the magazines later, and then the publication could be an abstraction combining both into one term. Everything we knew from object-oriented design is still valid. But then the problems come. There are many ways to change the values in the database. We could update the person's data directly, or for the book, like updating the author's name if we notice a typing mistake, or by swapping the order of authors or editors again for the book. We could add an edition or modify the publisher, once again starting from either end of the connection. Complexity. Accidental complexity is pouring in. DDD addresses this explosion of different joins by grouping entities and values into aggregates. Every operation becomes a consistent operation on a single aggregate. All references are to another aggregate's root. An entity designated the root position in the group of related entities and values. This revolutionary idea addresses two burning issues. One is transactional consistency, SDDD posits that we only make updates to one aggregate at a time and commit them as one atomic transaction. Well, that is a mind-bending idea. The other is, however, removing a heavy burden off our backs. We know how to join tables in a relational database or how to load the data from a document store. Always join all the entities from one aggregate. Always store one aggregate as one document. The worst part of dealing with relational databases, choosing the right joins for each operation, is now gone. And document storage just received a proper universal definition of the document. That, on the other hand, made querying appear harder. We always noticed that tendency to update data in one or two ways, but to query them in all sorts of unrelated ways. Query all the people we know of, query authors of one book, query all published authors, query the unique last names of book authors, query the list of initial letters of all published authors, query the authors of books by a specific publisher, query the authors of books by a specific publisher where an electronic version of the book is available. Enter CQRS. The channel you're watching is dedicated to C# and .NET programming. Subscribe for more and become a sponsor at Patreon. That will give you access to the source code from all the videos on this channel and a preview of a future video course I'm currently producing. You can also join the Discord server, where you can ask for help or engage in ongoing conversations about C# and .NET development. All the links are in the description. Enter CQRS, the command query responsibility segregation, one of the fundamental enablers when dealing with data. Let aggregates streamline the commands, but leave queries as a separate aspect. We may store the aggregates in document storage, which does not support versatile queries. No problem. Store the data again in a relational schema and then apply SQL to query them efficiently. This looks eventually consistent. It doesn't have to be. You can work with immediate consistency for the entire application's life, so long as database performance warrants that. Keep all the data in one relational database. Perform updates and queries freely. It makes sense to start the true separation only when the database can no longer respond to all the requests. You will likely need to separate reporting data first, which hardly tangles the application. However, introducing a proper CQRS with separate databases means you will have to embrace eventual consistency. That will make a profound change in the way you design operations. You should not cry for immediate consistency. Having to split the database means your system has become a success and the people are using it and relying on it. That doesn't change much compared to what we always did with relational databases. The substantial change the aggregate design has brought is that now we have a streamlined method of materializing the objects in memory to run the domain logic that ends up in a database update. All other things being equal, the domain-driven design has greatly simplified the data modifications by introducing this concept of aggregates. It came with a price, though. Remember, the complexity will not go away. The request to always work on a single aggregate is quite limiting. Corner cases that don't fit this idea will exist, too. The first release of the DDD book did not have a proper answer to those corner cases, so Eric Evans patched the theory later. He introduced domain events, persistent objects that say some change has happened. A change in an aggregate could trigger a chain reaction in other aggregates. You can also use domain events to feed the query part of the system based on CQRS. Many designs that used to cause trouble had fit into place with this updated DDD theory. Let me tell you that you don't need all these elements in every design. Most notably, the full-blown CQRS is an overkill in most designs, but a savior in others. Choose wisely. CQRS on top of a single database can simplify your code and even improve its performance. Query the data efficiently with rich and versatile queries. Let the user select the operation and its target from the results displayed on the screen. Materialize a single aggregate based on the choice. Call a method on the aggregate, save changes to the database, and commit. One must appreciate how straightforward this idea is. Even if you only adopted entities, aggregates, and CQRS and ignored everything else, your object-oriented designs will look much better than without those. That is, I think, the most significant impact DDD has ever made. It has changed the way we think of regular object-oriented models.